coming soon. The courage lies inside. Unseen, unknown, waiting. Then, lightning strikes and your world changes in the blink of an eye. And all you have is your strength, your faith, your courage. Courage Girl, coming soon.
You just have to accept what happens and face it. And I didn't know what was happening, but I was not scared. I've always been a busy person. You know, I chase after dogs and cats and kids and try to organize my husband, who that's a feat in and of itself. And I'm busy all the time. That's my life. And I just figured I was tired because I was getting older.
You had no idea as to what was going to happen. I said to myself, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. All I can do is love her today. And that's what I did.
Every day I look up into my garden, or I see a bird, or I see my dog chasing the ball, I take that heartbeat of a second and think, isn't this a wonderful, wonderful place? We are so lucky to be here. We are so lucky. Anything can happen in a moment and it might be gone. The 29th of July was a Sunday, and I woke up still feeling kind of tired, but feeling just perfectly like I always do. So I got up and I fed my birds and I fed the dogs and played around with them, doing the things that I normally do. And I am sure that nobody who saw me, wherever I went, I'm sure nobody would have said, that woman will be dead by tonight.
And then push down. Yeah, what if you're laughing?
We were going to have supper, and Barb made the salad and the vegetables and all that good stuff.
My husband went out to grill. My son was 17 at the time, so he's on the cell phone up in his room.
And we were sitting at that table, took a couple bites, and all of a sudden,
it was like a lightning bolt struck my head. And after that, it just felt sort of a fuzzy tingling in my head. My hands apparently started to shake. My son was sitting across from me, and he asked if I was okay.
I asked her, are you all right? And she said, no, I'm not.
I got up, I started feeling nauseous, and I stood up from the table. My hands were still shaking, so my son stood up too. My husband, I was just kind of passing by him, and just collapsed. He's an ex-hockey goalie. And he just caught me before my head hit the floor, which I think is probably a good thing.
Then all of a sudden, she started breathing like that.
I remember hearing my son holler, call 911, call 911.
Confusion, a lot of confused thoughts, like, what's wrong, what's going on, is she going to be okay, what's going to happen?
I have thought how grateful I am that I was not driving the car when it happened, that I could have killed someone.
It was tremendous fear. What is this? What is happening?
The White Bear EMTs took me to St. John's, which was the closest, nearest hospital.
Her body temperature was very low. It was like 92 degrees and dropping. They did some head scanning, and finally the doctor came out and told me that we think your wife has multiple aneurysms in her head.
The doctor who was taking care of me told my husband I had to go to St. Joe's if I was going to live.
Based on the CAT scan, all we knew was that there had been some bleeding around the base of the brain. We had no idea that she had more than one aneurysm at that point.
They probably had a pretty big job ahead of them, but they never made me feel like I was going to die. I remember Dr. Nussbaum just flat out saying, our goal is to get you out of here, to home, and have your life back. And I thought, okay.
An aneurysm is essentially an area of weakness in the wall of one of the blood vessels, one of the arteries bringing blood supply to the brain. And so that area of weakness gradually over time can bulge out and enlarge, much like a balloon that's being inflated, where blood can get into it, swirl around, and come back out. The wall can actually burst, and blood can leak out into the space around the brain, and that can be very dangerous. Although we know that a fair number of people actually have aneurysms and aren't aware of them, if an aneurysm does bleed, there's probably a 50% chance that you don't survive. And of the survivors, about half are left with some permanent disability.
He's young, he's brilliant, he has common sense.
They don't do it with the great doctor specialist doing something, and then the patient goes over to the great second doctor specialist and the third. They do it all as a team.
From a medical perspective, I think, you know, what was really unique about her case was just the sheer number of aneurysms that she had. 13 aneurysms, which is a lot, and represents something of a challenge, you know, to us and to her. I told them that I thought there was a high likelihood that we'd be able to get her through this.
They're beaming when you can say your name. They're just, eyes are twinkling.
When somebody comes in and they've had a rupture, but they're in good condition, they're talking to us and they're awake and, you know, they're able to interact and be part of the discussion, that's the most important thing that we look at. She didn't have any aneurysms located in places that we hadn't successfully treated before. But so we start with a skin incision, then we have to open the skull.
They literally take off a portion or flip back. I don't ask questions like that. But he then put metal clips on 8 of the aneurysms on that side of my head.
We take a titanium clip, which opens and closes like a little clothespin, and that allows us to pinch off the aneurysm, stop the blood flow from getting into it. Blood can't get into it. It can't leak out. The other major way to treat aneurysms is what's called coiling or endovascular treatment. It's the newer treatment. It's less invasive. We'll take a catheter and feed it up from the groin artery all the way up to the carotid arteries or the vertebral artery in the back. The blood vessels represent a highway or give you a roadmap to get up to the aneurysms.
Coil, coil, coil.
Come up into the aneurysm and fill the aneurysm with platinum wire. They pass an electrical current through that wire and it actually detaches the coil. And that essentially fills it up, and then again, blood can't get into it.
When you can smile, they are ecstatic. They are so supportive.
Emotionally, the people who came to visit her were much more of a wreck than she was. Yeah, she was truly just, that was the courage she showed. She was hanging in there.
She was in an intensive care unit that handles these types of accidents all the time. So to them, they knew exactly what they were doing, but it was very scary to see her. You know, she wakes up and you realize that you're still talking to Barb, that she's still okay, she's still in there.
You know, we all kind of sat and thought, well, what if she was gone? It's like, what, it would have just changed everything. You know, my little girl said, she's like, but nothing can happen to Grandma. She hasn't taught me how to knit yet. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like.
It's really, you know, humbling to me, the degree to which we've improved and changed the quality of the people's lives afterwards. And, you know, really, having a brain aneurysm when I was in training not that long ago was such a devastating diagnosis, and people just accepted that the outcome was not going to be good.
Pick up, starting up here. Right. And we're going to work sideways this time. We're going to work on a diagonal.
This is a mother. This is someone's daughter. This is a wife and a teacher.
So pick out which one you want.
They're back doing what they want to do, and they're not sick anymore.
Good job.
If you can correct the problem, you can cure the person.
You got it. I am just fine, and I feel better than I have felt in 20 years. In this miraculous day, we do not need to die from brain aneurysms.